Welcome back to The Line. The pandemic and the stay-at-home orders that were close on its heels have stunned cities, counties, schools, and the state when it comes to budgeting. Santa Fe announced it's planning furloughs. APS says it's now, quote, in crisis mode for the next year's budget, and lawmakers are likely to meet in June to figure out just how ugly next year's state budget will look. The state is the big dog, certainly. What's most likely to change? Merritt Allen, I'm curious what your early thoughts are. A lot of fruit out there, as they say, low-hanging and otherwise.
While I appreciate the state's response being very proactive in response to the virus and generally agree with it, the fact that we're not acting on the budget right now really has me nervous. And we're talking about mid-June, so 2 weeks before this budget's supposed to go into effect. I think that's a real problem. We're looking at a $2 billion shortfall. We're going to have to take some serious cuts. And of course, everyone's hoping for federal aid because the federal government is literally printing money right now between loan programs and quantitative easing. But in the state, we can't do that. We have a finite amount. We have a balanced budget amendment. So this is really important. And we need to focus on where it's going to impact, have the best impact. We've got to continue providing services. That goes without saying. We need to preserve infrastructure because that supports the jobs, particularly those lost. You know, everyone is talking about the Permian Basin and the oil patch. Grant County lost more than 1,000 jobs this week as Chino Mine furloughed just about everybody.
Wow.
Then you've got county hospitals, who are the second largest employers probably in Lee County and Grant County. They can't operate. We've got a real crisis that the state's going to have to address with aid and also provide some resources to getting federal aid. So, yes, this is going to be an ugly year. And I don't think we should. I think we should make decisions about our budget sooner rather than later.
Mm-hmm. Andy, the governor has mentioned one-time spending projects are on the table. Of course, everything's going to be on the table. We'll cover raises here in a quick second, too. But let's talk about projects. What's the likelihood of that? That seems to be politically perilous, it seems to me.
Yeah, I think when it comes to the budget, I think it may be a little premature to start looking at what sort of short-term projects that might be cut, especially because it's up to the legislature, but you have to have an agreement sort of between the governor and the legislature to get something through. So
Good point.
Think we just kind of have to wait to see what they present.
Mm-hmm. Very good point there. Laura Sanchez-Rivera mentioned raises. This was a highly anticipated bump for teachers across statewide. And I'm seeing folks, even the APS folks are quoted saying, look, it might not happen, honestly. Should we be prepared for that?
I think it would be prudent to be prepared for that. I really think that we're seeing some major cuts even beyond what APS has already discussed as being an issue. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're looking at probably a $2 billion shortfall.
Right.
With all said and done, it's going to be really ugly. They're already having to figure out how to make the current budget work, let alone budgeting for the next year. So I think that that's a real problem. And it's hitting a lot of local communities. If you look at what different cities are doing as well, everyone's having to look at how to roll out a plan to deal with the current budget shortfalls and then trying to anticipate the next budget year, which starts July 1st.
Right.
To make things work then. So I think we're just starting to see the impacts right now. We're going to continue to see them. I sit on a charter school board where we're already anticipating, you know, how are we going to meet expectations to finish out this budget year? We just went through the process of approving a budget this year for next year, mm-hmm. and submitting it to the public education department. And I think everybody's in the same boat where they're going to have to really look at that as like, okay, that's your budget. But the reality is, in June, when the legislature is likely to meet, we're probably going to be working under a whole other set of assumptions.
Good point there. Merritt, obviously, we got to get in Yazzie-Martinez. What's the upshot there for in this whole discussion about budgets?
I guess what we're looking at is everyone's going to be underserved probably in some manner than what we've been used to. Will the most vulnerable be underserved as that settlement tried to reverse. And so I think when it comes to allocating what funds we have, certainly the most underserved students need to be looked at first.
Mm-hmm. Andy, I mentioned furloughs for Santa Fe. I got to think other municipalities will follow suit as the weeks go along here. But let's talk about Santa Fe here for a quick second. It's the seat of our government, of course, here in our state. It seemed to me when I was reading over what was being proposed for furloughs that the language sounded to me like, folks, we're not going back to the way it used to be, that staff reductions are going to be our new permanent, you know, way of being for a while now. Did you get the same sense of that?
Yeah, I think that there's possibly some of that sort of, I wouldn't say hidden, but sort of in there to unpack. You know, there's a lot of talking about departments that are already sort of inoperable right now anyway, and sort of moving people around. And so I do think it's yet to be seen what that new normal is, which departments are going to be open for in-person sort of, and where you need the or where you can afford to have staff there.
Right. That's a good point there. Hey, we're up against the clock. Thanks to our panelists for creating home studios to join us on the line. Thanks, guys, for sure. Finally, this week, we continue our series of conversations with journalists around the state who've been braving sometimes unsafe conditions to provide essential stories while we all stay at home wondering what's going on. Here's Laura Paskus with Adrian Hedden of the Carlsbad Current Argus.